This morning, my goal is to get a few of these chickens harvested, and we're not going to really probably focus too much on that process, but more so on the performance of the scalder. What I'm trying to do is run this thing on my solar generator, although now that I've got it all hooked up and see how much power it's drawing, I'm not sure that this is going to keep this scalder running all day long. As a backup, I do have a gas generator if I need to help the solar generator out a little bit, but we'll just kind of have to keep an eye on that and see how it does. I mean, it's obviously pulling a lot of power right now because everything's heating up, but once that water gets to temperature, then the heating element should just kind of click on and off as it needs to maintain it. So once we get to that point, maybe the solar panels will be making enough power to keep up with it. I don't know. I've got the timer going because I am curious as to how long it's going to take for this thing to heat up. I've heard anywhere from an hour to 4 hours. So we will see how long it takes mine. I'm sure that time is going to depend on ambient air temperature, the water temperature going in, and a bunch of other factors that are hard to control, but we'll see what I get. My plan is to work on chickens for a few hours this morning, but as you can see, I've got the equipment trailer here and all of my tools because I want to try to get a little bit more done on the corral as well. That's what's going on today on Farmer Tyler Ranch. Scalder's been on for 36 minutes. Let's see where we're at. Looks like we're at 114. So we're getting there. I've got it 3/4 of the way full of water per the instructions, and I've got it turned on, set to about 140 degrees. First impressions, it appears to be built well, but I've got two complaints already. The first one is after threading in the drain spigot here, it is pointing up, and it seems like it would work a lot better if it was pointing down. So I don't know, I'll probably put a wrench on that and see if I can take it that next half turn to get it pointed down, but I don't have anything with me. So for today, it's gonna be this, I guess. And the other thing is that it's leaking. It's got a drip here in the corner. I can't tell quite where it's coming from. I think what I'll have to do is when I'm done with it and turn it off and let it cool down, I'll try to get in there and see where the leak is coming from. We're just over 56 minutes and the heating element shut off on the scalder, so let's temp it, see what it actually got up to. I've got it set to 140, so we'll see where we're at.
It's steaming a little.
Well, my thermometer's saying 137. That's pretty darn close. 137 is hot enough that we could get started. I think I'll click it up just a little bit and try to get more to that 140 to 145. I prefer to keep my water in the hotter range of the spectrum because when you're pulling birds out, water comes out, and then you gotta add more with the hose. So, you know, by doing all that, the water cools down. So if you kind of maintain a higher temperature, then it sort of stays more where you want it, if that makes sense.
It's been a few more minutes now after turning the thermostat up, and it looks like thermometer's still adjusting, but we're about 144.6. We'll call it 145.
That's right where I want it. So in total, I'm gonna say it took this an hour to get up to temperature, which is the best time that I have heard. I've heard anywhere from an hour and a half up to 4 hours. And I've just been thinking about what would cause that. I'm sure your input power has a lot to do with it. And then the ambient air temperature, if you're trying to do this when it's 40 degrees outside, it's probably gonna take your scalder longer to heat up. I would say today it's probably around 80 degrees right now, so it's not real hot, not real cold, and that's what it took for me. Your results may vary. I got all the butchering done that I'm gonna try to do today, and I gotta say, the scalder is a huge upgrade from using a turkey fryer. Once it got up to temperature, which took just about an hour, it was able to hold temperature no problem, and running it on the solar generator actually ended up working out just fine. It took about 60% of my battery to get up to temperature, but once it was there, you know, and it clicks on and off to maintain that, my solar panels could pretty well keep up with that. So we got to about 40% battery and really just stayed there. So there you go, the Stromberg chicken scalder. Few little issues, but overall worked good for me. All right, let's move on to something else. Well, I ended up spending most of the day butchering chickens, which is unfortunate for filming purposes, but I did still want to try to come down here and get a little bit more done on the Corral project and also answer some of the questions that I've been seeing pop up a lot in the comments. The first one was about my pipe spacing, saying that I should put the pipes closer together down low so that I don't have any issues with calves getting through them. And I don't disagree, that's not a bad idea, but keep in mind that I'm going to be putting solid paneling from the bottom pipe all the way up to the top pipe. So the pipe spacing doesn't really matter on this project. In fact, I want it to be even because it will then equally support the paneling. I think I'm going to end up using plywood and probably treat it with like used motor oil to try to make it last longer. Another thing I saw somebody say was they were kind of surprised at how much space I am taking away from my working corral, because with, you know, this fence being here, we're taking a big chunk out of the corral. That is true, but remember, I used to have panels here. The panels were essentially in the exact same place, maybe, you know, an inch or two one way or the other. So it is taking a big chunk out of here, but it's no different than it was before. And in addition to that, eventually the plan is to move this fence line out like 3 or 4 feet, and that will give us some of the room back. It won't give it all back, but it'll give some. I think there's been some confusion about the removable panel, and I've also been talking about a gate. This is not the gate. This is the removable panel. It will mostly stay right here for the foreseeable future. The only reason why I would take this down and move it out of the way would be if I need to get the squeeze chute out of here for whatever reason, if it was to get replaced, or, you know, if it broke in such a way where it was easier to take it out. Those would be the only reasons I can think of where I would want to get that out of here. I could see maybe taking this panel down to like dump some gravel back in here, but I think honestly this panel is going to get built in place and never move. The gate that I've referenced several times will go here, and when this gate is open, you'll be able to bring cows from the working corral back into, I'll just take you on the route, they'll come right up in here and go that way. That puts them into the tub, which in turn leads them into the squeeze chute. Last thing, several people mentioned that I should make these pipes a little bit short so the removable panel is a lot easier to get in and out. But instead of making the pipes short, what I did is I clamped the square tubing to this side of the angle iron, which pulls it back. And as you know, the what would you say, like the crotch of the angle, basically, on angle iron, it's not a perfect 90. There's like a little radiused edge in there. And what that ends up doing is pulling the square tubing in ever so slightly. So there is like a 16th of an inch gap there. In fact, I'll take this clamp off and show you how loose it is. So you guys were right. We definitely wouldn't want these square tubes fitting in here super tight, because it would make removing the panel difficult, but it would make getting it back in nearly impossible. It wouldn't be impossible, but it would be very tough. I do appreciate the questions, so keep them coming. I know sometimes I don't always explain things the greatest. So if you've got any questions about what I'm doing, go ahead and leave them in the comments.
hot for these gloves. Get my welding gloves on.
All right, well, these little gloves are not gonna cut it. That pipe is super hot. I'm gonna need to wear welding gloves to carry that thing. That ought to be better. I think it's time for some new welding gloves. I got a hole in the tip of my finger, and you know, when you're welding, I guess you never really would notice that, but when you're carrying pipe, you sure do. Another thing somebody asked me was how much these pipes weigh. These originally were 30 footers that I got cut down to 20s. I just cut 10 feet off of them so that I can haul them a little bit easier on the trailer. I think the full length 30 footers are around 200 pounds. So if you do the math, a 20 footer is probably somewhere around 130 pounds. And because I cut these with the Portaband, the cut side is usually not a very straight cut. I'm usually just trying to do it fast and get out of there. So I'll cut, you know, a short section off with the chop saw to get a good straight edge. Then I'll take my measurement and make my second cut. So it's kind of a bummer because you got to cut it twice to get one piece. I've got this 2x2 angle iron here. I'm gonna cut these half circles out so that it fits right up against this pipe. And then the flat side of the angle iron will be on this side. It'll give me a good place to mount the plywood sheeting that will eventually go up here. And it's gonna tie all this pipe together and make sure that things don't move, or that if one pipe bends, they all have to bend, and I just honestly don't see that happening. Well, I've got dinner waiting for me, and I'm all out of water, and this seems like a good place to take a break, so that's what I'm gonna do. I'm back down here in the working corral again, just when I've been doing any kind of hot work. Even though I didn't do any welding today, I still was making some sparks with the grinder and the saw. I always just sleep a lot better if I come down here in the evening and check on things again and just verify that everything's okay. It's also during this time that I can kind of look at my work, see what I've done, maybe try to figure out what I want to do next, or if I want to change the plan that I've already come up with. And one thing that I have been thinking about is this big space over here. We've got this big just sort of dead area over here, and I don't know what to do with it. Over here we're gonna have the table. Obviously here we've got the man gate, and then we've got what? Nothing. I don't know what to do with this. If you guys have any ideas, I'm all ears, because I got nothing. I've been trying to get a little bit done on this project every day because I need it to be done, or I need it to at least be to a usable state, because if I need to get a cow back in here for some reason, I don't want to have a bunch of areas where the fence isn't good, or it's down, or it doesn't exist, or you know, you want to at least get to the point where you could run a cow back in here if you had to. So because of that, I am trying to work on this, even if it's just a little bit, every day, and, you know, pretty soon we'll get there. And once I get this project finished, now that I have it and the AeroQuip in here, something that I would really like to do before summer is over is run all the cows through the AeroQuip chute, take blood samples from them, send them off to the lab to see who's pregnant and who's not. All right, you two stay here, okay? You stay. I'm gonna try to move this wire without turning off the juice, just because I really don't want to drive all the way down there, and I think if I'm careful, I'll be all right. That's not what I wanted. Okay, we're good. Go. This irrigation handle is one of the first things that I've made when I bought my welder after I got out of high school. You might not know by looking at it, but this chrome handle is actually a set of bicycle handlebars that I cut into pieces and then welded back into the shape that I wanted. The shaft here is made out of rebar, and I guess I must have had some rectangular tube to make the end. I kind of chuckle about this because it's pretty obvious that I just made it with what I had laying around, and, you know, back then I didn't really know how to weld that good. I didn't have near the amount of experience that I have now. But I graduated high school in 2003, which makes this thing over 20 years old, and I'm still using it. And the point of me telling you this is because, for one, I think it's kind of funny that I'm still doing the same stuff over 20 years later, just cobbling something together with what I got laying around to make what I need. But also because even when I didn't have a lot of knowledge or a lot of experience, I still tried, and I still made something that ended up being really useful for a lot of years. So if there's something that you've been wanting to learn how to do and you don't have a lot of knowledge and you don't have a lot of experience, just go try it, because there's only one way that you're gonna gain those two things. Believe me, I made a lot of things like this before I started making things like that, because everybody's gotta start somewhere. Thanks for hanging out with me today, guys, and I hope I'll see you again on Farmer Tyler Ranch.